Now that we've obtained the regression model, we want to assess how well the model fits the sample data. Recall the regression model is given here by the equation of the trend line. In expressing regression equations, it's a commonly accepted practice to place the intercept term first. So we might write this as y hat is equal to 1.2739 plus 0.0678 times x. Better yet, we might express the equation in terms of the original variable names, so it's easy for people to understand. So we might write it like this: predicted time is equal to 1.2739 plus 0.0678 times the miles. Also, I should tell you that besides using the trend line, there are other ways to get the regression equation. One of those ways is to use the functions called intercept and the slope. What you do is you actually type the word intercept, then select the y values followed by the x values. So y values are here, the travel times, and comma, and then the number of miles. And the slope is the word slope itself, and again, y's first and then the x's. So you can see we get the same values that are shown in our regression equation. We could see that if we use a regression model to estimate the travel times, sometimes the predicted value will be higher than the observed value, and sometimes the predicted value will be lower than the observed value. So we want to calculate these deviations for our sample data. For each data point, we could calculate the y hat, the predicted times, by plugging in the x value into this formula. So for the first data point, y hat is equal to 1.2739 plus 0.0678 times 100, and that gives us 8.06. And the next one, 1.239 plus 0.0678 times 50, and that gives us 4.67, and so forth. So, of course, we could do it faster by using an Excel formula, so we'll do that now. Intercept over here, dollar signs, plus slope, dollar signs, times the 100. Okay, so there's a formula, and we could just copy this down. Now we compute the difference between each observed y value and the corresponding predicted value. So 9.3 minus 8.06, and 4.8 minus 4.67, and so forth. We could see for the first assignment, the prediction was lower than the actual time. So the error value, deviation value, was positive. And for the last assignment, the predicted value was higher than the observed value. So the error, which was observed minus predicted, was a negative value. Now let's say we want to sum up these errors to come up with a total measure of error. And that gives us, zero. Oops, what happened? It says our total error is zero. Of course, the problem is there are positive values and negative values that cancel each other out. So what we do is we square these errors before adding them up. As you know, when you square negative values, they become positive. Now we have the squared error values, and we'll get their sum. When we're told the regression model was obtained by the least squares method, it means out of all the possible equations, we chose the one that gave us the smallest sum of squared errors. By that, we mean this trend line is the best one out of all the possible lines we could use to fit these data points. So that's what it says here. You know, this part is your sum of squared errors we just calculated. Now, for instance, we could have chosen some other line that sort of went through the data like this, or maybe something like this. So there were, you know, many possible lines that kind of sort of fit the data. But the one given to us is the best one in that it minimizes the sum of squared errors out of all the lines that we could have chosen. So if we were to choose any other line, by changing the intercept and the slope, then we will end up getting a larger sum of squared errors, that is larger than 8.03. So as a demonstration, we're going to just try plugging some other intercept and slope and compute the sum of squared errors. Now, for example, maybe instead of 1.2739 here, we might want to try 1. And here, maybe we want to try 0.08. And now let's look what happened to the sum of squared errors. You can see here, it's 13.44, larger than 8.03 we had before. So far, we know that the regression equation here is the one with the least sum of squared errors. And we know the sum of squared errors in our example is 8.03. Now, recall that when we asked for the equation for this trend line, we were able to get this r squared value. Now, we'll explain what this r squared is and how it helps to evaluate the model. To do this, we need to define a couple of other sums of squares. Now, hypothetically, let's think about what kind of errors we would get if we did not bother to use the distance, the number of miles, to predict the time that the trip will take. Let's say you're given only these y values, you know, the times for the driving assignments, and without the number of miles attached to them, and you're asked to give the best guess at how long the next driving assignment will take. Then your best guess might be just the average of these given times. That's really the best you could do given the limited information. So then what you're saying is your estimate, that is y hat, is equal to 6.7, or the average of your data. You could think of this as a baseline model, something you come up with before doing the analysis, as opposed to the regression model we have here. This baseline model will give you a flat trend line like this with this equation. Now look at the deviations between the observed values and this baseline model. We could see that we'll get some pretty large error values here compared to the error values we would get from this regression model. Those errors are given here. You could see here is the observation, then subtract the mean, and that gives you the value here. 9.3 minus 6.7 is 2.6. 4.8 minus 6.7 is negative 1.9, and so forth. Now, if we take these values and square them, we get a column here, you could see. And then summing those squared errors gives us the value of 23.9. This total is called SST, for total sum of squares. So we could see that the 23.9, the total sum of squares, is much larger than the sum of squared errors from the regression, 8.03. So we could say that by using the regression, that is, by predicting the driving time based on the miles driven, we have reduced the total squared errors from 23.9 to 8.03. We could also see this in this chart containing both of the models. Here is the baseline model with the y bar, and This blue line is a regression model we have. Let's take a look at the third assignment, which has 8.9 as the observed value and 8.06 as the predicted value from the regression. So that's this dot over here. Here is the data point. So y sub 3 is 8.9, and the predicted y from the regression is 8.06. So the difference here, the y3 minus y hat, is the residual. That is 8.9 minus 8.06, which is 0.84 here. Let's write that down. Now the error from the baseline model is the difference between the 8.9 here and the sample mean of 6.7. So it's 8.9 minus 6.7. That is this value minus 6.7 here. And the difference is 2.2. So that's this difference, as opposed to the difference between observed and the predicted from regression. So in this case, we could say that the error decreased from 2.2 to 0.84 when we went from the baseline model to the regression model. And we could also say that the regression model improved the prediction by how much? Well, by this much, which is the value predicted by regression minus the mean. So that's 8.06 minus 6.7. That gives us 1.36. So we could say 1.36 is sort of the size of the improvement from using the regression model. So from this, we could see there are three kinds of deviations. The observed minus the predicted value from regression, that's over here. The observed value minus the mean of the data, that's this part, is over here. And the difference between the predicted value and the sample mean, that's here, is in this column. The values in these three columns are squared in the last three columns, and in the bottom here are the respective sum of squares. So what I'll do is I'm gonna copy this over here. Let's review those three sums of squares we just looked at. There's a sum of squares due to error, or SSE. That would be the sum of squares of the residuals, that is the observed data value y minus the predicted y value. And that was 8.03. Now total sum of squares gives us the measure of the error if you were using the sample mean to predict the travel time. So that was a naive baseline model. And that error is going to be large. Now, sum of squares due to regression, or SSR, represents how much the predicted y values from the regression deviate from the average y value. It turns out if we take y hat minus y bar, and then add y minus y hat, then the y hats cancel each other out, so we end up with yi minus y bar, which is this one. So it makes sense that for each row, if we add these two deviations, we get this other one. Now it turns out the sum of squares of these deviations also work the same way. That is, if we take SSR and add SSE, then we get SST. Here's a way to think of this relationship. Let's say we're looking at the travel times, and we ask, why do some driving assignments take longer than others? Why aren't they all equal to a single value, like the mean of 6.7 hours? Well, SST is a measure of the variation of the y values around the mean of 6.7, so it's 23.9. One reason there is a variation is because of different driving distances. The longer distances are associated with longer times. So the variation of the travel times explained by the relationship between the times and miles correspond to SSR, and that is 15.87 in this case. However, the distance, the miles, doesn't account for all the variations in the driving time, so the remaining variation attributed to other factors is the SSE. So if we take this SSR and divide by SST like this, it gives us the proportion of the variation in Y explained by the regression model. And that proportion is called the coefficient of determination, or R squared. In our example here, that proportion is 0.6641. So we could say that 66.41% of the variability in the travel times can be explained by the relationship between the miles traveled versus the travel time. Now, the R squared should be between 0 and 1. Now, if the model fits the data perfectly, then all the variations can be explained by the regression model. So SSR will be equal to SST, so then R squared is equal to 1. If the model doesn't fit the data at all, then the regression model does not explain any variation, so SSR will be equal to 0, so then R squared will be equal to 0. Now this R squared is actually a square of the correlation between the observed Y values and the predicted Y values. So if you have the R squared, you could always get the R by taking the square root. Now remember, R is a value between negative 1 and 1, but R squared is between 0 and 1. Now if you have the R squared and you want to get R, you would just have to take the square root of the R squared. So like from here, we would say R is equal to square root of 0.6641. Now, how do we know whether it's positive or negative? It depends on the direction of the relationship. In the above example, the slope of the relationship was 0.0678, so it's positive. So we know that the correlation must be positive. If the slope was negative, then the correlation would also be negative. So the sign of the correlation coefficient follows the sign of the slope.